صلى الله عليه وسلم: أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. وبعد، so inshallah we are continuing our study of the seerah, the biography of our beloved Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. And we are still studying Ghazwat Badr, which took place in the 17th of Ramadan, in the second year of the Hijrah of our beloved Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم from Mecca to Al-Madinah. And as we have come to know, that Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم didn't intend to go for a battle. He only intended to intercede one of the caravans of Quraysh that was led by Abu Sufyan before his Islam, because later on he became a Muslim, Sayyidina Abu Sufyan. But at that time he was not a Muslim yet. And the caravan had only about from 30 to 40 gods, and it had a huge amount of money and of gold. And it was the intention of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Muslims to intercede the caravan to get back some of their stolen properties and money that was or were taken unrightly from them in Mecca before their migration to Al-Madinah. Brother Arqam, sorry, give Brother Abdul Rahman one bottle of water. He's in the kitchen. Sorry. You know the where is the water, yes?
Yes.
Yes, okay. Okay, so اللهم صل على محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. So the caravan could escape because Sayyidina Abu Sufyan was a very clever leader. So he could escape. News came to him that the Muslims were trying to intercede the caravan, and he could escape. But before escaping, he Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. But before escaping, he sent somebody, as we have come to know, to Mecca to send him an army to support him against Muslims who have gone in this mission to intercede the caravan. They were about maximum, they were 317. But he could escape before the army, he had escaped before the army reached his place. But Quraysh insisted to make it a big battle against Muslims, or they insisted to remain there near to Al-Madina in the valley of Badr for 3 days, which was, and they said that they would do so to let everybody know that they are the strongest in this area and they are dominating the area, and that nobody can object to any of their decisions, and so on. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam decided to go to the same place where they have encamped to show them that he was not fearing them anymore, and if they are camping there, then he would not go back to Al-Madina, but he would encamp in the same place as well, to show them that also Muslims are strong. And not, of course, you know, for any pride or something like this, but just to stop them trying again and again making aggressions against Muslims, and to stop them thinking that Muslims are weak, because they were planning and they have already planned to kill the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in Al-Madinah and to attack Al-Madinah. And if would think at that time that Muslims were weak, then this would give them a better chance to try again to attack Al-Madinah and to invade Al-Madinah and to kill Muslims there and to kill the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. So there was no choice for the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم other than just to go to the same place and to encamp there and to show them that if they are encamping there, to show that they are strong, so Muslims do not have any fear from them and they can go to the same place and encamp there and defend the Medina from outside the Medina, not to wait inside the Medina until the 1,000 warriors from Mecca, you know, would go to them inside Al-Madinah. So, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as we have come to know last week, alhamdulillah, he, when the companion Al-Hubab ibn Munzir suggested that it was good that Muslims would proceed in the valley of Badr until they could reach the nearest water or well of water to the army of Quraysh, and then that they would encamp there by this well. The valley was named the Valley of Badr, and it had different springs of water or wells of water. So Sayyidina Khabab ibn Munzir, he suggested that Muslims would proceed marching until they reach the nearest well to the Quraysh, and then they encamp there. And they, his suggestion was that Muslims had to destroy all other wells so that Muslims can have water and their enemy cannot have water. Because they intended to stop the war. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't like to fight against them. So this was done to let Quraysh know that now you don't have access to water. So it's better to you to go back to Mecca. You have a lot of water there. So why do you stay near to Medina threatening us and desiring to attack us? So this was to stop war to happen. But unfortunately, the Quraysh, though they didn't have water, they insisted, and of course Abu Jahl was the main one who insisted not to go back. And they, he said that they had to fight Muslims and they had to give them a lesson to let them not to think again that they are going to be powerful nation or powerful people at all. To let them forget about being able at any point of time to have any power. We have all the time just to suppress you and to let you understand that you are the inferior and we are the superior, we are the powerful, we are going to control the area, we are going to take all decisions, and you have just to shut up, you don't speak, you are weak people. So of course Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't like this, and this is not Islam, it's not the Muslim personality. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was used to do justice to both Muslims and non-Muslims, and he entered into agreements in Al-Madina with the Jews and with the disbelievers of Al-Madina, telling them that he's going to defend them against anyone who would do any aggression against them, and they were non-Muslims. So Prophet Muhammad actually didn't like injustice to be done against Muslims or to be done against non-Muslims. And his message was to spread justice and to spread kindness among his people and to spread love among his people. So now Prophet Muhammad and Muslims are encamping by the only well of water at Badr, and Quraysh is very near to them and they don't have water. But this didn't prevent Quraysh from proceeding to attack Muslims. They were very arrogant at that time, and they thought that they had to be all the time the most powerful people. So the battle started not by Muslims, but it started by the disbelievers. So one of them, whose name was Al-Aswad ibn Abd al-Asad al-Makhzumi, he stepped out his camp and he proceeded to the well of Badr to attack Muslims there, to kill them, and to kill as many people as he can from them, and also to destroy the well of Badr. So he went, but سيدنا حمزة ابن عبد المطلب engaged with him, the prophet, one of the prophet's uncles, engaged with him and killed him because there was no choice. He has started the aggression, and this area was near to Al Medina, so they have announced that they are staying there to threaten Muslims. And then Muslims didn't start. Muslims just kept their place, but they started, and this one who was a bad-tempered idolater, and he just started the fighting like this, and Sayyidina Hamza ibn Muttalib, Ibn Abd al-Muttalib could kill him. Okay, ألكم جزاكم الله خيرا. الله يبارك فيكم. الله يبارك فيكم. I am happy that you joined the lecture, of course. جزاكم الله خيرا. الله يبارك فيكم. But if you have any other thing, you feel free to. This is your decision. جزاكم الله خيرا. الله يبارك فيكم. الله يبارك فيكم. Okay. And then, after Al-Hamza ibn Abd al-Muttalib had been killed, three men amongst the strongest ones in the army of the disbelievers, and they belonged to one family, they stepped out also to fight against Muslims. And they were Utbah ibn Rabi'ah, Shaytah ibn Rabi'ah, and Al-Walid ibn Utbah. So two brothers and a son of one of them. And then they asked for three men from the Muslim side to come out and to fight with them. So they asked for fight one by one, person by person. So three men from Al-Ansar came out to fight them. And they were Auf ibn al-Harith, Muawid ibn al-Harith, they are two brothers, and Abdullah ibn Rawah. All of them were from Al-Ansar. So those three disbelievers asked them, where are you from, or who are you? They said, we are a group from Al-Ansar. We are some people from Al-Ansar. So they told them, Akfa'un kiram, you are competent, noble persons. ما لنا بكم حاجة, but we have nothing to do with you. وإنما نريد بني عمنا, but we want to fight with our cousins. So they wanted to fight with the Muhajirin, someone from Al-Muhajirin, not from Al-Ansar. And then they called, or they shouted, يا محمد أخرج لنا أكفاءنا من قومنا. O Muhammad, let our peers from our own people come out to fight us. So now look at this. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam started to say, stand up, so and so. And this means stand up to fight, to go out of the Muslim camp and to face one of the strongest men of Quraysh, face to face, and to fight him. So imagine that all the companions from Muhajirin were just waiting. Anybody's name could be mentioned, and all of them were ready to obey the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he mentioned three names, and all of the three straightforward they came up and they went and they met with those three people from the disbelievers. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, قم يا عبيدة بن الحارث وقم يا حمزة وقم يا علي. So Prophet Muhammad sallam chose three persons. Two of them were Sayyidina Hamza, his uncle, and Sayyidina Ali, his cousin, and Sayyidina Ubaida ibn al-Harith, he's one of the first Muslims who accepted Islam very early in Mecca, in the very early days of Da'wah. So this is the leadership in Islam, that you don't escape responsibility, you face, you carry out responsibility as it should be carried out, and you don't put others at risk, but you give all people equal treatment, whether they are your relatives, whether yourself and all other people equal treatment. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them, go forward for the combat. Those three companions and all of them, of course, obeyed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam happily. And this shows that, alhamdulillah, how their understanding was like, because they were defending a right cause, and they were doing this for a good purpose. They were defending their land, and they were defending their own lives, and they were defending their own wives, daughters, children, and so on. So they happily did this. And when Utbah ibn Rabi'ah, Shaybah ibn Rabi'ah, and Al-Walid ibn Utbah saw them, they could know them, of course, they know them very well. So they said, أنتم أكفاء الكرام. You are noble peers to us. And you see, they were fighting together, but this was the language used at that time. Even people had something of the good morals. I can see it in the language, at least the language. So Sayyidina Ubaidah ibn al-Haris fought against Utbah ibn Rabi'ah. And he was an old man at that time. He was one of the the oldest men in who have come for this interceding this Quran. And Sayyidina Hamza ibn Abd al-Muttalib, he fought with or against Shaybah ibn Rabi'ah, and Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib fought against Al-Walid ibn Utbah. So all of these three disbelievers were killed. So this is another victory for Muslims. The first one was killed, and those three also were killed. So now Quraysh could retreat easily because battle has not started yet. And they have come to know that Muslims are really good fighters. But Quraysh didn't. And Sayyidina Ubaidah ibn al-Haris, maybe because of his old age, he received a severe hit from Utbah ibn Rabi'ah, which cut off his leg. And this led to his death after the end of the military campaign of Badr, or the Battle of Badr, 4 or 5 days later. He died as a martyr. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, he is one of the Sabiqeen and Awwaleen, those who accepted Islam in the very early days of Islam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala witnessed for them in the Quran. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gather us all with them, inshallah, in paradise with our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Quraysh people were, of course, frustrated because of these two situations, that now four of their men, of their precious men, best men, had been killed. But also they were so much angry, and this led them to fall upon the Muslims in order to destroy them once and for all. So they started 1,000 people attacking Muslims, and desiring to kill them all and to destroy them all. And Muslims, they conducted a defensive war plan, because the number of the non-believing army was very big, and Muslims were, their number was, a small number. So they conducted a defensive war plan. They only defended themselves against the disbelievers. And this plan of Muslims was successful enough to inflict heavy losses in the side of the disbelievers. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam kept calling upon Allah day and night for help and support. And when the engagement with the non-believers grew too hot, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam increased his supplication and calling upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he said, Allahumma in tuhlik hadhihi al-isaba al-yawma la tu'bad, ya la tu'bad ba'da dhalik. اللهم إن شئت اللهم إن شئت لم تعبد بعد اليوم أبدا. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam starting to call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he felt the difficulty of the situation to the extent that he said, O Allah, should this group of Muslims be defeated today, you will no longer be worshipped. And this shows that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's intention was to, and his main concern, and the thing that he worked for was to, you know, to help people to be obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to get the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to be rescued from hellfire. And that's why he didn't say, Oh Allah, should this group of Muslims die today, I will be very sad for this, for example. Or their families will suffer a lot. No. Because Prophet ﷺ knew that if anybody is killed in a battle like this, and I put 100 lines under this sentence, in a battle like this, or in a battle for, you know, a good purpose, for defending, you know, the wronged people, and of course it should be guided by the, you know, the not to be done on individually. Should be decision should be taken by and agreed upon by you know, Muslim big entities and so on, and authorized one as well, and guided by the you know, the fatwas of the most authentic ulama and so on. But anyway, when all these conditions are met, and when there is a battle, and of course Islam is not for battles, for sake of battles again and again, but if it has to happen, then when it happens and someone is killed as a martyr, then he is in paradise. So Prophet Muhammad is not sad if they would be killed for sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for sake of spreading justice. But he was sad because if this group, because they were the only Muslims at that time, would be killed, then this means that all people would not come to know about Allah, would not worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this was his main concern. Then Prophet Muhammad sallam continued making dua more and more, to the extent that his cloak, like the abaya, fell down on the ground or the floor. And because he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was stretching his hands high like this and making dua, so his cloak fell down on the ground. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu picked it up and put it back on the Prophet Muhammad sallam. And he told the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, حَسْبُكَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ أَلْحَحْتَ عَلَى رَبِّكَ. He said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger of Allah, you have cried out enough to your Lord. You have cried out enough to your Lord. And then he told him that وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ مُنْجِزٌ لَكَ مَا وَعَدْ. And Allah is definitely fulfilling his promise to you, that he's going to give you Al-Nasr. And this sentence from Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, and of course he is the best of all believers after our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said it out of pity for the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam kept making dua, raising his hand for, as the narrator has said, for all day and night, all day and night making dua. So and Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, of course he loved Prophet Muhammad sallam and all the companions, but he was the closest one to the Prophet. So he just told Prophet, this is enough. You have made a lot of dua, O Messenger of Allah. Allah is definitely answering your dua. So that's enough now, O Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is, you know, this is a human beings, you know. But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was thinking in, of course, he was sure that Allah is going to fulfill his promise, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does never, of course, break his promise. But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as you know, when he would pray for the whole night, until his feet would be solid. And he was told, "Oh Messenger of Allah, you do all of this. وَقَدْ غَفَرَ اللَّهُ لَكَ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ." Allah has already, or had already forgiven you all your shortcomings. So you don't need to do all of this. But Prophet Muhammad said, "أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا." Shall I not be a thankful and grateful servant of Allah, or servant to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So Prophet Muhammad, he understood, of course, and he, the Prophet, is the messenger, that dua is ibadah. Even if you know that Allah is definitely going to give you this, but dua is ibadah. You do it out of humbleness before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a sort of, making ibadah, you know, doing something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you to do. And Allah, in one hadith, Prophet Muhammad has also told us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves those who repeatedly say and makes the dua. And yulih fi dua, an insan ladhi yulih fi dua, who repeatedly asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the same thing. This is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this very moment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed some verses of the Holy Quran, of the Noble Quran, from Surah Al-Anfal. إِذْ يُوحِي رَبُّكَ إِلَى الْمَلَائِكَةِ أَنِّي مَعَكُمْ فَثَبِّتُوا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا سَأُلْقِي فِي قُلُوبِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا الرُّعْبَ فَاضْرِبُوا فَوْقَ الْأَعْنَاقِ وَاضْرِبُوا مِنْهُمْ كُلَّ بَنَانٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he has already revealed or inspired to the malaika, the angels, that he subhanahu wa ta'ala is with them, supporting them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded them to keep the believers firm. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the verse is going to tell how. But then the verse says, سَأُلْقِي فِي قُلُوبِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا الرُّعْبَ, I will cast in the hearts of these believers the الرُّعْبَ, which is fear from Muslims. فَضْرِبُوا فَوْقَ الْأَعْنَاقِ وَضْرِبُوا مِنْهُمْ كُلَّ بَنَانٍ. Then strike over the necks of the disbelievers and smite over their tools and their fingers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Prophet Muhammad sallam that al-malaika, the angels, were actually sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fight with Muslims, to help them with fighting. And this, of course, gave firmness to the hearts of the believers. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet إِذْ تَسْتَغِيثُونَ رَبَّكُمْ فَاسْتَجَابَ لَكُمْ أَنِّي مُمِدُّكُمْ بِأَلْفٍ مِّنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ مُرْدِفِينَ. Consider that when you have sought help from your Lord responded to your invocation and by telling you that he is giving you for support 1,000 angels, مُرْدِفِينَ, coming in succession, following each other. Then Prophet Muhammad while he was in his trellis and Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq was with him, he dozed off, which was a sign that he received a revelation. And then he raised his face again, or his head, and he called loudly in joy while he was happy. صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, أبشر يا أبا بكر أتاك رسول الله هذا جبريل آخذ بعنان فرسه يقوده وعلى ثناياه النقع. الثنايا هي يعني مقدمة الأسنان, على ثناياه النقع هو غبار المعركة, يعني يبشر أن سيدنا جبريل نفسه يقاتل مع المسلمين. He said, Oh أبو بكر, receive good news. Victory has come to you from Allah. This is Jibreel riding his horse, and on the face of the horse in the sandstorm of the battlefield. So even the greatest angel and the greatest angels like Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam, they joined the battle with Muslims. And this was, of course, good news for the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and for all Muslims. Then Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم came swiftly out of his trellis and because the trellis was in a high place, so Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم came out of the trellis and he صلى الله عليه وسلم was wearing his armor and he started reciting in a loud voice. Allah is saying, سيهزم الجمع ويولون الدبر. The multitudes will be defeated and they will turn their backs, escaping from the battlefield. And Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم took a handful of gravel and threw it to the direction of where the non-believers were. And he, while doing so, he صلى الله عليه وسلم said, شاهت الوجوه. May confusion seize their faces. And it was a miracle because when Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم did so, a violent sandstorm blew into the eyes of every one of the disbelievers who joined this battle. So this was of course like a miracle that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to his Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells about this in the Noble Quran when we read وَمَا رَمَيْتَ إِذْ رَمَيْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ رَمَى. And you have not thrown when you threw, but it is Allah who has thrown. Because Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم did something that if anybody else does would not cause the same reason. So this was obviously by the support of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave the clear command to all the Muslim army to start the counter attack, because now their position was a better one. So they started a counter attack, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam inspired confidence amongst the Muslims, and he encouraged them to fight manfully for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, saying قُومُوا إِلَى جَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضِ. Like, come to a paradise which is as wide as the heavens and the earth. And he also said وَالَّذِي نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدٍ بِيَدٍ لَا يُقَاتِلُهُمُ الْيَوْمَ رَجُلٌ فَيُقْتَلُ صَابِرًا مُحْتَسِبًا مُقْبِلًا غَيْرَ مُقْبِرٍ إِلَّا أَدْخَلَهُ اللَّهُ الْجَنَّةِ. By him in whose hands my sword is, whosoever fights them today, and today here is very important to let us understand that fighting is not always rewarded. If fighting is not for a valid cause, then it is not rewarded. It is not a good deed. But Prophet ﷺ said, "Al-yawma, today, in this situation, because we are the wronged people, and it is our right to fight against them. Everyone, whosoever fights against them today, while he is patient and while he is seeking reward only from Allah, is not fighting for any purpose or any." Think money or anything in this life or even reputation, but only for sake of Allah. مُقْبِلًا غَيْرَ مُدْبِرْ, while he is marching forward to the where the enemy is, and not غَيْرَ مُدْبِرْ, and not turning back, then Allah will definitely give him paradise as a reward. So Sayyidina Umayr ibn al-Hammam, and he was one from Al-Ansar, companion of course, and he was from Al-Khazraj. When he heard Prophet Muhammad ﷺ saying so, he said, Bakhim Bakh, like, great, great. So Prophet Muhammad ﷺ asked him, مَا يَحْمِلُكَ عَلَىٰ قَوْلِكَ بَخِمْ بَخْ, why have you said great, great? So Sayyidina Umayr ibn Hammam said, لَا وَاللَّهِ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ إِلَّا رَجَاءَ أَنْ أَكُونَ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا. No, by Allah, I have only said this, O Messenger of Allah, hoping to be one of the dwellers of paradise. So Prophet Muhammad ﷺ told him, فَإِنَّكَ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا. So you are one of the dwellers of paradise. So Sayyidina Umayr knew that he is one of the pillars of paradise, so he liked to go to paradise. And he had a container of his arrows, so he took some dates from this container and he started eating the dates. And then he said, لَإِنْ أَنَا حَيِيتُ حَتَّى آكُلَ تَمْرَاتِ إِنَّهَا لَحَيَاةٌ طَوِيلًا. If I live until I finish eating these dates, then this is a very long life. I like to go to paradise now. So he threw away the dates that he had. فرمى بما كان معه من التمر ثم قاتلهم حتى قتل. Then he fought against them until he was killed as a martyr. So he was given the good news by Prophet Muhammad that he will be a shaheed. He will be a martyr. So he knew that he will be a shaheed. So you know, there is no you know, no use of staying. I'll be a shaheed. Then okay, let me be a shaheed now to go to paradise quickly. Okay. And also Muslims were encouraged so much to, you know, to fight when they saw the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam fighting in front of them. فَلَمْ يَكُنْ أَحَدٌ أَقْرَبَ إِلَى الْمُشْرِكِينَ مِنْهُ. So no one was closer to the disbelievers and the army of disbelievers more than the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in strong determination, kept saying, سَيُهْزَمُ الْجَمْءُ وَيُوَلُّونَ الدُّبُرُ. سَيُهْزَمُ الْجَمْءُ وَيُوَلُّونَ الدُّبُرُ. The multitudes will be defeated and they will turn their backs. And then the companions started to see the work of the angels. I mean, they started to see the support of the angels in the battlefield. So it was not all something, you know, it was a real thing. So Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما narrated, he said, بينما رجل من المسلمين يشتد في إثر رجل من المشركين أمامه. While a Muslim amongst the you know, the Muslim army, in the Muslim army, was chasing one of the disbelievers, and this disbeliever of course was in front of him and he's chasing him. استمع ضربة بالصوت فوقه. He heard over him the swashing of a whip, and he also heard صوت الفارس يقول صوت فارس يقول أقدم حيزوم. And he also heard a voice of a warrior saying أقدم حيزوم. Oh حيزوم, go ahead. And حيزوم, this was an angel. So they were two angels and they were speaking to each other. And then this companion who was chasing a disbeliever, he didn't do anything for the disbeliever. But suddenly he found that disbelievers was falling down, killed. So when he saw the Prophet, when he met with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam about it. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him, صدقت ذلك من مدد السماء الثالثة. You have told the truth. This is the help and the support that came to us from the third heaven. So this was something real that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is capable of everything and can do whatever he wills to do, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another story showing how the angels helped Muslims in this battle, that one of the Ansar took Sayyidina Al-Abbas ibn Abd al-Muttalib as a prisoner of war, as a captive. Because Sayyidina Al-Abbas ibn al-Muttalib, he was Muslim, but he was hiding his Islam. So, and he at that time, he lived in Mecca. He didn't migrate to Al-Madinah. So when they went in a big number, everybody went. So he had to go with them. So he just went with them. So he was taken by one of the Ansar. He didn't know that he was a Muslim. He was hiding his Islam. So he didn't know that he was a Muslim, and anyway, because he was hiding his Islam, so he took him as a prisoner of war. And then, when they went to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Sayyidina Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, and he is one of the uncles of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, of course, he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Inna hada wallahi ma asarani." By Allah, this person did not capture me. لَقَدْ أَسَرَنِي رَجُلٌ أَجْلَحٌ. The one who captured me was bald. What? With a bald head. مِنْ أَحْسَنِ النَّاسِ وَجْهًا. And he had the most handsome face. عَلَى فَرَسٍ أَبْلَقْ. And he was riding a piebald horse. And the piebald horse is the horse which is both white and black. White and black. وَمَا أَرَاهُ فِي الْقَوْمِ. And I cannot see this person here among this you now. He's not one of you. He's definitely not one of you. So the man from Al-Ansar, who was very happy to bring one, he was thinking that he was a non-Muslim. So he said to the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, أَنَا أَسَرْتُهُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. No, it's me, O Messenger of Allah. I have captured him. Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم told him, أسكت فقد أيدك الله بملك كريم. أسكت فقد أيدك الله بملك كريم. Be quiet, for Allah had strengthened you with another angel. So it was not really you, it was another angel. So this was the help and support, one side of it, of course. Now, Iblis, the devil or Satan, who came at first in the shape of Suraqa ibn Malik, al-Mudliji. You remember when Quraysh, in the very beginning, when they prepared their army and they were about to go, but they thought maybe the tribe of Bani Bakr may threaten them from their back. So they thought not to go, especially when they knew that the caravan has already escaped. So Shaytan appeared to them in the shape of Suraqa ibn Malik, someone that they knew, and he told them, don't worry, Bani Bakr will never be able to do you any harm. I guarantee this for you. So you go, I am protecting you. And he was with them all the time. The Shaytan was with them all the time. But when, because the Shaytan can see the angels, so when he saw what's happening to the Muslims, he started to try to escape and to leave the battlefield. So Al-Haris ibn Hisham, one of the disbelievers who were in the disbelievers' army, he took hold of Suraqa ibn Malik al-Mudliji, who was the Shaytan actually. And he told him, where are you going? You told us that you are protecting us and that no harm will touch us. So he gave him one big hit, one big strike. So Al-Haris ibn Hisham fell down, and then the Suraqa ibn Malik, or the Shaytan, continued running away. So some of the other disbelievers, they told him, إِلَىٰ أَيْنَ يَا سُرَاقَ أَلَمْ تَكُنْ قُلْتَ إِنَّكَ جَارٌ لَنَا لَا تُفَارِقُنَا. Where are you going, Suraqa? Have you not said that you're going to protect us, you will never leave us alone? So he said, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed in Surah Al-Anfal, إِنِّي أَرَى مَا لَا تَرَوْنَا إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ. I can see what you cannot see. I fear Allah, and Allah's punishment is great. Ulama, the scholars said, Qatada, he was one of the big mufassirs, he said, وَكَذَبَ عَدُوُّ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهِ مَا بِهِ مَخَافَةُ اللَّهِ وَلَكِنْ عَلِمَ أَنَّهُ لَا قُوَّةَ لَهُ وَلَا مَنَعَ. Because the verse says that the shaytan thought, إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ. He left them saying this, saying, I can see what you cannot see. I feel from Allah, and Allah's punishment is so great, so big. So he did it actually. This saying of this mufassir, وَكَذَبَ عَدُوُ اللَّهِ عَنْدِي, this enemy of Allah, the shaitan, told a lie. This is a lie. By Allah, he did not fear Allah. He Subhanallah, he doesn't, because he is a big sinner and the leader of sinners, if I can say. ولكن علم أنه لا قوة له ولا منع. But he knew for sure that there was no one at that time and in this situation to defend the disbelievers. So and to defend him as well. So he knew that he had to escape at that time. So he ran off and jumped into the sea, because he is a shaitan. Then the Quraysh, okay, and you see, this is always the manner of the shaitan, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Hashr, كَمَثَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ إِذْ قَالَ لِلْإِنسَانِ اكْفُرْ فَلَمَّا كَفَرَ قَالَ إِنِّي بَرِيءٌ مِّنْكَ إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهَ رَبَّ الْعَالَمِينَ. So this is always the, the work of the shaitan, like this. In this verse number 16 of Surah Al-Hashr, Surah number 59, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells that the shaitan, he tells man, or disbelief in Allah. And then when man does it and he becomes a disbeliever and a disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he says, oh, I am disassociating myself from you, and I fear Allah, the Lord of all the worlds. But then the following verse is, فَكَانَ عَاقِبَتَهُمَا أَنَّهُمَا فِي النَّارِ خَالِدَيْنِ فِيهَا وَذَلِكَ جَزَاءُ الظَّالِمِينَ. So the consequence of them, that both of them will be in hellfire forever, and this is the end of the wrongdoers. So then Quraysh, of course, started also to retreat, and then the retreat turned into a shameful runaway, and then they started to fly in haste. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives victory to Muslims, alhamdulillah, and we will stop by this, and we will continue with the also speaking about Badr inshallah next week inshallah. So jazakum Allah khair, alaik short dua inshallah, jazakum Allah khair. اللهم لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك وعظيم سلطانك. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد في الأولين، وصل على سيدنا محمد في الآخرين، وصل على سيدنا محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. اللهم نسألك الجنة وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل، ونعوذ بك من النار وما قرب إليها من قول وعمل. اللهم اغفر لنا ما قدمنا وما أخرنا وما أسررنا وما أعملنا وما أسرفنا وما أنت أعلم به منا، أنت المقدم وأنت المؤخر، لا إله إلا أنت. اللهم نسألك رضاك والجنة، ونعوذ بك من سخطك والنار. اللهم نسألك العفو والعافية في الدنيا والآخرة. اللهم نسألك حسن الخاتمة. اللهم اجعل خير أعمالنا خواتمها، وخير أيامنا يوم أن نلقاك فيه. اللهم اختم لنا بخاتمة السعادة أجمعين. اللهم نسألك الثبات في الأمر والعزيمة على الرشد، ونسألك شكر نعمتك وحسن عبادتك، ونسألك قلبا سليما ولسانا صادقا، ونسألك من خير ما تعلم، ونعوذ بك من شر ما تعلم، ونستغفرك لما تعلم، إنك أنت علام الغيوب. اللهم إنا نسألك بأنك أنت الله الأحد الصمد الذي لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. اللهم نسألك ألا تدع لنا في ليلتنا هذه ذنبا إلا غفرته، ولا ضالا إلا هديته، ولا سائلا إلا أعطيته، ولا مبتلا إلا عافيته، ولا مظلوما إلا نصرته، ولا هما ولا كربا إلا نفسته وفرجته، ولا مريضا إلا شفيته، ولا ميتا إلا رحمته، ولا حاجة من حوائج الدنيا والآخرة إلا قضيتها ويسرتها يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم احفظنا واحفظ أبناءنا وبناتنا في هذه البلاد، اللهم احفظ المسلمين أجمعين من بين أيديهم ومن خلفهم وعن أيمانهم وعن شمائلهم ومن فوقهم، ونعوذ بعظمتك أن نغتال من تحتنا. اللهم من أرادنا والإسلام والمسلمين بخير فوفقه له، ومن أرادنا والإسلام والمسلمين بشر فاجعل دائرة السوء عليه ورد كيده إلى نحره، وأرنا فيه عجائب قدرتك يا رب العالمين. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. رب اغفر لي ولوالدي وللمؤمنين يوم يقوم الحساب. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. وصلى اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك، أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت، أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. وجزاكم الله خيرا. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليماً.